Hello, everybody. It is 10 p.m. Central Time on Tuesday, December 13th, 2016. Welcome into the Earthquake 3D live stream. Good to see everybody here. And I do have the better camera running tonight, so at least you can see me a little bit better. Maybe I might be a little small. You might have to full screen it to get a better detail on my face. But you're not here to look at me. You are here to look at the globe and see what's going on with seismic activity, because we are on the Earthquake 3D live stream, where we daily recap events from around the planet. So I would just like to start off with the most recent significant earthquake, which is a mid-range 4 that just struck in central Italy. Now, you may remember last night's warning, we issued a specific warning for a mid-range 4 to be striking in central Italy by tonight. And they just upgraded it to a 4.35. We'll see that go up or down in a little bit. So again, it could go between a 4.3 to 4.5. And that's noteworthy in size. That comes after the activity of the 4s that were over to the east yesterday. You see the 4.5 at the Caspian Sea and the 4.2? Let me get the other smaller earthquakes off there so you can see that. Okay, see that? All right, well, that pushed to the west and caused a mid-range 4 in central Italy. We still haven't seen the 4.9 west of Crete. I may cancel the warning tomorrow. I'm going to give it 12 more hours. But regardless, I mean, that's an area out in the ocean. There's nobody that lives there, okay? So it's not like central Italy where we're trying to get the magnitudes just exactly perfect. And so we'll give it till tomorrow west of Crete out there in the Mediterranean. But it looks like the pressure is transferring past that region and going straight up into Italy. Not only into Italy, but passing out through Italy. Take a look at the last day's worth of earthquake. And this is the bigger earthquakes. These are all the 2.5 plus. Now you see this? Starting over in the Middle East, going across Turkey and Greece, going right up through France, and it's going to carry on out across into the Mid-Atlantic Ridge, going to our termination points where we have our X marks the spot. Okay? So, again, Italy just struck. As I was getting ready to go on, maybe just about 20 minutes before I went on. Secondly, today, over in the West Pacific, take a look at the earthquake activity that developed since last night, guys. I mean, it is so obvious. We talked about Papua New Guinea, right? Okay, well, not only Papua New Guinea, but west of Papua New Guinea, east of Papua New Guinea, north of Papua New Guinea, equidistantly spaced, same size earthquakes. Okay, so going 5555 all the way west, and then as we go north, look right along the Izu Ridge at north of Guam, south of Japan. Now, this is not the spot in Japan where we're looking for the movement yet. We issued a 72-hour warning for that, and today is 48 hours. We have 5.8 going up the ridge. Now, this falls right in line with the magnitude I'm looking to strike up in Tokyo, just further proof that the pressure is transferring. I mean, take a look at it. Following our lines of progression. So, in other words, going west from our deep earthquakes out to the west, northwest, and it will continue on to the west over to the Middle East. Now, get this. Over the next 48 hours, since we've seen so many fives press out across the West Pacific, this is actually going to carry over into Asia and cause a more like mid-range 5. I have to up the magnitude watch and move it over just a little bit. We actually have to move it over to the east by, let's say, 300 miles over to eastern Nepal at the India border. Why do we have to move it there? Well, Cinnabung showed new eruptive activity today, guys. So Cinnabung erupting equals a 5.0. We have the other fives coming in from the Pacific. That's going to tally up and total into a single release, most likely east of Nepal, eastern Nepal, into India. Okay, India actually goes over to the east here as well. It's not just the big landmass that everybody's familiar with down to the south. It also goes over to the east slightly. But anyways, so take a look at it. It's pretty obvious pressure spreading out from our 5.0 earthquake activity yesterday. But today, a new 4.7 struck earlier this afternoon. Very deep. Another deep earthquake. Well, what does this mean? Well, it means, guys, that the deep earthquake event is carrying on. This one at 454 kilometers depth, over 300 miles deep. And that's another sign that whatever is causing this is carrying on. And if it's going to carry on, that means we have to watch for additional larger earthquakes. So is it pretty obvious the pressure's transferring to the west? I mean, look at the last 48 hours worth of earthquakes. All right, now I need to turn on the GeoNet feed, which is going to show us the activity down in New Zealand, since we issued a warning for New Zealand, north of New Zealand. We do have to watch for one more day to the north, and I'm looking for the potential of a 5.9. Not that big of a deal, since it's not going to be striking on land. The reason I'm looking to the north, first of all, it hasn't been hit by any noteworthy activity in a little while. When I say a little while, it's been a couple weeks since anything over a 6 up north of the island, or near 6. There's been some 6s on the North Island, and a lot of activity still down here at the north tip of the South Island. That's to be expected. I've told you guys multiple times over the past several days, every time we see a deep earthquake up to the north, just like we saw today, another deep earthquake, that immediately puts pressure upwards and outwards onto New Zealand. Well, when that happens, the pressure hits this spot that already broke, right here at our red arrow where it goes across New Zealand. Okay, that already fractured, that released with, what was it, a 7.8 earthquake and 6 feet, 2 meters of movement up and down, rise and fall. Okay, so these deep earthquakes keep that fluid, keep it in motion. Constant release, 2s, 3s, even some 4s and 5s mixed in with that. But it's not going above there, at least not anytime recently, because it's fractured. It's already broke. So you can't really break it anymore. It's going to keep releasing the pressure as soon as it comes in. The other spots to the north and to the south along the plate boundary are going to be under stress and will release with larger earthquakes, larger than the earthquakes that are striking on the North Island. As we see more deep earthquakes, more movement's going to be striking in New Zealand. It's pretty much a given at this point. So, over the next 48 hours, what do we watch for? Well, since we've had two new deep 4.7 and 5.0 earthquakes, and since the swarm is carrying on here again down right along the plate boundary, that means the North Island's under pressure and the 5.9 watch carries on. Why 5.9? Well, a 4.7 can lead to a 5.7 to 6.7. The previous day's 5.0 can lead to a 6.0 to 7.0. But as you can see, most of the pressure off that is going to the west, which means there's going to be equal size movement, but it's only going to be one single earthquake, okay? And it's going to tally up to the total of everything that struck to the west. 5.8 plus a 5 plus a 5, that takes us to like 5.9 and a half, okay? So that's what we're watching for down here in the South Pacific. As we go up into Japan, there's one spot that I'm watching that's near Tokyo. Again, in Tokyo, just south of Tokyo, into Tokyo proper. And we're watching again for that magnitude to be in the 6 range. 6 range is possible, maybe more like upper 5, since it's a 5.8 and some other 5 to the south. But let's put it at 6, and if we're a couple points off, so be it. Now, I did make a misstatement this morning when I got on and did my update, or was that last night when I did my update? When I did my last update, I forgot to mention that not only are we watching on the coast of California at the Gorda Escarpment for a new round of earthquakes to strike, but we're adding back in Vancouver, BC. So Vancouver, British Columbia, west of Vancouver, BC, near Bella Bella, where that swarm location is occurring. Okay, well, in between Vancouver, and technically that's Alaska that comes down here with the Alaskan Island Chain. But it's a very small little area, okay? And we're going to need to watch it for large movement, larger than what struck in the past, I don't know, 4 or 5 weeks? So that means, again, it's been just 3s there, 4s there. It's going to go up a whole notch, more like upper 5, like what's going to strike down here along the coast of California. Both areas should be hit. We have upper 5s already creeping up towards Japan. It's only a matter of time before these two spots are struck. When I say a matter of time, maybe let's put it at 48 hours. Let's put it at 48. Okay. Additionally, check this out, guys. Over on the east coast of the United States, 3.0 striking at Nova Scotia. East Coast 3.0. Why did a 3 strike on the east coast? Well, Midwest was struck by a 3.0, obviously, just in the past day. But we go back a couple more days and take a look at the swarm that hit in Oklahoma. So it's a whole step less. Well, in the Midwest, it's two steps less. On the East Coast, it's one step less. So over this past week, I was looking for, since the 6.5 struck on the West Coast, I was looking for similar sized movement in the Midwest with a single larger earthquake. Instead of a single larger earthquake, a swarm, you can see it, obviously broke out, and it topped out near 4.0. Actually, it was above 4, but they went the low ball on it. It's 3.7, whatever. So you add these all together, that's a noticeable swarm because it was completely quiet for many days' time. Now, over to the east, the leftovers off that went across the New Madrid seismic zone, went across Ohio and struck the fracking operations last night and this morning, and then now, Nova Scotia struck on the east coast. Craton movement from the west to the east. And the larger the movement is on the west coast, the larger the movement is in the Midwest, the larger the movement it is on the east coast. It's just that simple. And these are just the larger earthquakes above 2.5. If I show you guys everything under 2.5, all the small earthquakes, what we call microquakes, you'll be able to see the last day gives away that a few other interesting things developed, like a swarm up in Yellowstone. Now, you may remember we issued the warning for Yellowstone after the 6.5 struck. We said it would just be a matter of days and Yellowstone would be struck by a new swarm. Well, not only is it struck by a swarm, but it's a significant swarm. So it's happening inside the park, it's happening at the park perimeter, and it's happening at the magma chamber boundaries, which go up into Montana and go all the way west into Idaho. And that's expected. It's a super volcano, of course. Everybody knows about Yellowstone. It's not going to erupt. It's a sign of seismic pressure coming down from the northwest and pushing to the east. Same time that happened, actually, over the last day and a half, that 3.3 and small swarm of earthquakes broke out at Mount St. Helens, which now the YouTube opportunist have showed up and started to say that there's all kinds of stuff happening at Mount St. Helens and that people are feeling shaking and all kinds of stuff. That's a load of baloney. The channel that's doing that always capitalizes on these things, especially at Christmas time. So let's just remember, Mount St. Helens isn't due for an eruption. And if it was due for an eruption, there would be warning signs showing up, such as massive inflation of the dome, which there's not. More than just 120 earthquakes, that's just, for a volcano, that's absolutely nothing. And there was a 3.3 that struck several days ago on the flanks of Mount St. Helens, just letting us know that pressure's in the area. Of course there's pressure in the area. A 6.5 struck within the past several days. Take a look down to the south. All the dormant volcanoes down to the south are moving too. Do you see those channels? That very same channel that's talking about Mount St. Helens shaking. Are they talking about this earthquake here? Let me go ahead and look this one up. This one's way larger than the one up at St. Helens, and it's at a much more interesting location that is a super volcano, not just a regular volcano, like Mount St. Helens, and I don't see them making a big deal about this. Oh, wait, that's right. They don't know about it because they don't look up earthquakes. They just opportunize on different situations that are bad news, or it could be considered bad news. So as we look here, here's Walker Lake, right? You say, oh, well, there's no volcano there. Yes, there is. Right on the flanks of Walker, we have volcanic formations, which have been actually marked by the Google Earth community. And we have pictures there of volcanic outcrops, ash, solidified ash. I mean, it's pretty interesting. Okay, so that spot there, and then further down to the south, we actually have lava flows from an unnamed volcanic butte that rises about 200 or 300 feet off the desert floor. You can see the cone and sill on that. We have Aurora Crater just to the west, which is much more well-known, but it also has exposed basalt and lava flows off of it. Okay, Aurora Crater. And then that's part of the greater Mono Lake supervolcano that's right here. So I guess you guys can see all this, right? Here, let me turn my photos back off. So you can see all this. This is related to Mono Lake overall. So you have Walker Lake, Mono Lake, and connected by volcanoes. Well, it's not just that spot. That's where the three struck today, letting us know that pressure is getting larger. I told you guys yesterday that we see ones and twos mean like a four off the West Coast. I'm sorry, zeros and ones mean a 4.0 off the West Coast. Warning sign. Okay? Ones and twos mean more like a five. Okay? Twos and threes mean more like an upper five to six, as I told you last night. I'm just repeating what I told you last night. So now we have twos and threes striking here at the volcanoes. The swarm down to the south has pretty much stopped at Salton Sea. The pumping operations are being hit by here's a 3.0 striking at your pumping operations, guys. Take a look at this. This is in southwest San Joaquin Valley, which I just had a viewer send me a bag of pistachios that came from there. And when I show you what's there, I think you're going to be interested to know they're growing pistachios in this same location. Okay, here we go. Here's where our earthquake struck. And here is a massive oil field. And you really have to zoom it in close because when you look at the mountaintops, they just look like little sandy outcrops, but they've actually carved away the tops on each of these mountains and put an oil well. So every single one of those is an oil well, and it takes some inspection because, man, we're talking thousands. Thousands of wells, guys, and it really is no exaggeration. Here, let me give you another example. Up here, another good example. As I zoom in, okay, here's a solar farm, just to give you an example of what a solar farm looks like from above. But here, right next to the solar farm, is a huge oil field. It just goes on and on for miles, gas and oil being collected, and we have a 3.0, 2.8 earthquake striking just to the south, part of this huge pumping operation that goes on throughout the whole southwest San Joaquin Valley. Even goes down into the pistachio fields, where they're growing pistachios and fracking and doing oil right next to them. Okay? Interesting, right? That's not for water, guys. That is fracking and oil, and it goes, follows the line. Here's more, just in case you're wondering. So, I mean, it goes right side by side. Every single one of these little black spots is a different oil well. There's so many. It's wild, right? They look like ants on the ground. Okay, so what does it all mean? There's warning signs that show up before you get a larger earthquake off the coast. And the warning signs are your old volcanoes, ancient volcanoes, start to move, showing minor movement up to 3.0 activity. The larger the movement at the volcanoes, the larger the movement at the pumping operations equals the larger the movement that's coming off the coast. Something's pushing all of it right now. Let's imagine it that way. Something great up off the coast is pushing all of this. And when it gets to a point of saturation where it can't take anymore, the pressure backfills instantly up off the coast and strikes off the coast within a day. So, here we are. We're looking at twos and threes striking now, hitting your dormant volcanoes, your pumping operations. And to the north, we have the geothermal pump, pumping op. And look at it, guys. The geothermal pumping op has been robbed of pressure by earthquake striking to the north. West of Lassen. And again, guys, Lassen Peak is another location we could show you really quick, populated by thousands or at least hundreds of volcanic cones, spots where there's been so many eruptions in the past in Northern California. I don't think many people know about it. But let's just show you. Okay, we get up here. Here's Lassen. All right. And all around Lassen, we have all these different spots that have erupted in the past. And for every one that's marked, like Potato Butte here, there's four or five others going off in a chain that aren't, like this one here. Okay, so this erupted in the past. It's a cinder cone, that's what they call it. And next to it, there are. This goes up to Sugarloaf Peak, on all sides of Sugarloaf Peak. So just four or five right there. So going up to the north of California, we have these different spots. Then we get further and we get up to Shasta. Here's Shasta. And Shasta is accompanied by a huge volcanic field, consisting of hundreds, if not thousands, of cones. Just like all the others, this is a lava flow, high hole crater. And there's other craters down around it, so it's not just that. I mean, you can see where the past lava flows have happened. From Six Shooter Butte in the past. Also coming from here, Medicine Mountain. Not even marked as a volcano, but it should be, because it's on Medicine Lake, and here's the glass flow. This is a different type of lava flow called a glass flow. These happen over in Iran, actually. So they happen on plate boundaries. Here's more fresh lava flows to the north. Most people don't know about this huge volcanic history of Northern California. But it's not going to erupt. It just gets hit before there's earthquakes off the coast. Okay? So, what do you watch for magnitude-wise? Again, I told you, when you start seeing twos and threes at your volcanoes and your pumping operations, that's more like the sign of an upper five coming your way right off the coast to the northwest. Something's pushing all of California right now. It's actually going over further east than California, hitting Yellowstone, hitting Utah, hitting all of Arizona. I'm sorry, all of Nevada. And that lets you know, big pressure building off the coast. Now, East Coast has already been displaced, so that lets you know the pressure from the last earthquake finally reached all the way over to the East Coast. It's going to carry on, going to go right out to our X marks the spot, meet up with our pressure coming over from Europe, which again is coming off that 4.0 that I showed you at the start of the broadcast. So all in all, oh boy, at least in Europe and in the United States and in the West Pacific, the movement we were expecting to happen has already occurred. Now in Central America and South America, the movement's still at play. And when you take a look at Central America, you're going to notice a few things compared to yesterday. How about the fact that there's a series of fours going from the Gulf of California down through Mexico, Guatemala, into Costa Rica. Or I'm sorry, that's Nicaragua. Into Nicaragua. What does that mean? Well, the pressure that's spreading out is spreading out because of the previous deep earthquakes. You got to remember, go back 2 days. See these two earthquakes here? The 5.7 and the 4.7? Well, the 5.7 pushed in exactly as expected, hit our spot. We have pressure coming down the coast from our 6.5. We warned Baja, but we also warned south of San Diego, which this one's a miss. By the way, guys, this one is a miss. This 4.5 right here, we issued a warning for Southern California going as far south as just south of the border right here. Okay, so, you know, in between Salton Sea and Cerro Prieto, and instead it struck, well, I mean, a couple hundred miles to the south, 4.5. We issued the warning for 4.5. It just, you know, you can't nail them all. It's the same region, but that's not close enough for me. Okay, I want to get it down to a very fine point, down to a maybe 100-mile stretch. That's what I'm aiming for. But, you know, there it is. So, 4.5 did strike, and then pressure going down all the way down throughout Central America. This is all going to pool up. So we've got a 5, we've got a swarm of 4s. I would say there's, let's say, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8. There are 10 4s. Well, 10 4s equals 1 5. So we have a 5 and 10 4s. So that's really 2 5s. Well, if we add 5 and 5 together, that equals 5.1. It takes 10 5s to equal a 6. So you go up by 0.1 every 5 you add. And that means we need to watch to the east for a 5.1 to strike potential between Eastern Caribbean and our X marks the spot. Okay, so our X marks the spot, again, is standing out. We're watching for a 5.1 to press east to Venezuela and then further east to our X. And watch out for it within 72 hours or less, more like 48. Because it's still on the west coast of Central America and South America. We'll probably take a day to go across the Caribbean, strike over here in the Eastern Caribbean with a similar-sized earthquake. But ultimately, the ultimate destination for this pressure in Central America is to go out here and release with one final earthquake. Down to the south, the same thing happened. Pressure came in, caused our 5.0 earthquakes to develop. That then caused a new deep earthquake. Pressure is trying to go down and underneath the plate right now. And so we have an earthquake striking right inside of our letter D. You see that there? Okay, the letter D stands for deep earthquake. But these deep earthquakes are a little bit different. Now, I would like to point out, Edmund Kratzer, Bud, who I talked to on the phone last night, made me aware of something that we're going to have to add to the map here. And he's noticed, and other people have made note of this as well, who I trust, other moderators in here, that there has been a correlation between deep earthquakes in South America and similar-sized earthquakes over in New Zealand again, like a tennis match. So we may need to add one more arrow back down here to the south, just north of our X's, with a double-sided arrow letting people know that pressure not only stops down in New Zealand, but it bounces back and forth with the deep earthquakes. I don't think it happens with shallow earthquakes. I don't know if there's been a study, if we've studied it long enough to notice if there's been a difference with shallow earthquakes. But with the deep earthquakes, Bud noticed this. He deserves credit for it. And we need to get it on the map if it happens again. So I'm watching closely, and we need to watch for a similar sized earthquake. As we see this 4.1 here, watch for a shallow, larger earthquake of similar size, somewhere in the 4 range, to strike over here in New Zealand within a short period of time. If that happens, then you probably can start to see a correlation, and we will add the arrow. And that'll help. It'll help a lot of people down in New Zealand, because if there is a tennis match that's happening of pressure down here farther south, I kind of wouldn't be surprised, because it's trying to seek that eastern way out. And if it can't go down underneath the plate, where's it going to go? Could it get shot back over to the West Pacific? I wouldn't be shocked. Look at which way the fracture lines go. It's almost like they are rebound lines of some kind. Maybe that's what we'll call it, a rebound line. But we'll still come up with a term for it. We got plenty of time to do that. So, all in all, what are we going to watch for over the next couple days in Central America and South America? Like I told you, Central America is now going to press over to the east, and South America, this is going to press down to the east, southeast as well. So the potential for a very large earthquake right now in the East Pacific is small. I won't say it's non-existent entirely, but the chances of it are less until we see larger release over here in the West Pacific. The larger the earthquakes are over here in the West Pacific, the larger the earthquakes are in the East Pacific. East Pacific corresponds to what happens in the West Pacific, which is why you see fours and fives in the East Pacific today, after we saw fours and fives in the East Pacific yesterday. And today, now there's fours and fives in the West Pacific. See those here, right? All the white earthquakes. Which means tomorrow and the next day, there's going to be fours and fives over back in the East Pacific. Like a giant tennis match happening back and forth. But it follows the progression lines. But luckily, the only real good news out of this is that pressure escapes out completely and goes over to Europe and escapes across the United States Craton, North American Craton, and goes out to the Mid-Atlantic this way. So pressure does escape. Otherwise, it would resonate back and forth and probably build on itself. Think about it. You ever have a reverberation chamber? Ever do that where or you leave a microphone on when it's picking up feedback and it starts to do a feedback loop? And it starts going more and more and more as that wave passes back and forth in between. Well, if the Pacific didn't have a way to expend that pressure, it would. So, one other thing, real quick, I think we can all look at the screen right now. You guys, let's go check the volcanic activity report for today. Just make sure that there's nothing strange showing up. Okay, looks like we got Tsunamis Jima south of Japan erupting. Langila erupting again in Papua New Guinea. Dukono back again erupting. This erupts every day. Colima in western Mexico. Turrialba in Costa Rica. Reventador back in Ecuador. Sabancaya in Peru. Copihue in Chile. Well, that's a lot of eruptions over in the East Pacific. That's the follow-up movement off this last round of deep earthquakes. So, now that the volcanoes have erupted, now that their earthquakes have struck, over in the West Pacific, guys, East Pacific's going to compensate with that similar size movement. Like I said, we have to watch our silent zones. Which, oh boy, this could take another 15 to 20 minutes to explain, but I'll just quickly break it down for you. If you're new here, we watch the areas in between where the current earthquakes have struck over the last 48 hours. So let me bring up 48 hours worth of earthquakes. All right. So we watch the larger spaced areas in between the spots where we've already seen movement. Those are called silent zones, spots where there haven't been any earthquakes yet. And you calculate your magnitudes by adding the earthquakes with rough addition. It takes 10 fours to equal a 5, for instance. It takes 10 fives to equal a 6. It takes 10 sixes to equal a 7, and so on. So if it takes 10 fours to equal a 5, how many fours do we have here? Well, let's count them. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. Okay, so we got 5 fours. Well, that's a half of a 5. Okay, so that's a 4.5, right? Another way to look at it. four or five fours equals 4.5. Well, there's 1.5 mixed in there as well, right? A 5.0, I see it right here. Okay, so if we take the 5.0 plus the fours, that takes us to 5.1 or 5.045, which to me is just a 5.1. In other words, just basically a step above the five. We're watching the middle point between the two zones that have moved, which means, again, South Indonesia needs to watch for a 5.1 in the next day. Is anybody shocked? All the other 5.1s that are coming across. It just calculates the total for you, let you know. Okay? As we go to the north, we're watching for a little bit larger. Why are we watching for larger? Magnitudes are increasing as we go to the north. It's obvious. Went from 5s to 5.1 to 5.8, which means the next step up should take us right into Japan, and it should take us the next step up from 5.8. Simple arithmetic with simple Newtonian physics. Okay, and that's it. So now you know what we watch for. I did not issue a warning yet for over in Italy. Let's go ahead and get Italy on the warning list for tonight. They don't have to wait till tomorrow. I know there's a lot of people in Italy right now that are concerned after your four that hit. Today, there's been a 4.5 back here in Pakistan and Afghanistan, a 4.0 down in South Iran, and a swarm of threes going across Greece and Turkey. Well, the 4.5 plus this 4 or 3.9 and the other threes equals about a 4.6. So within 48 hours, we go back up to mid-range 4.6. Where? Central Italy at Norcia. Why? Because the plate boundary ruptured there, just like down at New Zealand. Whenever pressure comes in, it immediately expends itself within a day or two. Luckily, the potential for a large earthquake is less. The only time we have a potential for a large earthquake in Italy is when large pressure is coming into Italy, either from a deep earthquake or from a large earthquake over in Greece and Turkey. Sometimes Iran, but usually Greece and Turkey, are your determining factor for how much pressure comes into Italy. Greece and Turkey are like a pressure release valve. The bigger the movement in Greece and Turkey, the bigger the movement in central Italy. And you add it together. Rough addition. Like I told you just a few minutes ago, 10 threes equals 1.4. 10 fours equals 1.5. So we have 5 threes and a 4.5, which again equals the magnitude I just told you. Above 4.5 into 4.6. Okie dokie. So that is now our update for tonight. I will be on by tomorrow at around, probably around 11 till noon. And I'll do another update, updating on what we're looking for going into tomorrow and compare it to what we warned for tonight. So understand one more time, the areas we warned last night have been hit. A little bit less than what I was looking for magnitude-wise, spot on for the pressure transferring to the west. And that seems to be the way it's going this week. Since the 6.5 in the west coast, this whole deep earthquake event has kind of been one magnitude less than what we were expecting. Is that because the big ones already hit? Maybe. Maybe because New Zealand was hit, and the 8.0 hit, and Japan was hit, and Italy was hit. That all those spots, Indonesia was hit. That all those spots being hit over the last couple weeks has fractured the heck out of the entire plate boundary, which is allowing for pressure to release quickly. There's not many sticking points left, guys. It's gotten hit so many times over the past couple weeks. The largest earthquake of the year just hit. It was the 8.0 that hit over in the Solomon Islands. I don't know how that everybody missed that. Mainstream media missed it. All the people on YouTube missed it. They didn't catch that it was the largest earthquake of the year. It was an 8.0. They downgraded it to 7.8, but regardless of their downgrade, it still was the largest earthquake of the year. So, you know, there was one 7.8 that happened over here in Ecuador at the start of the year. But regardless, you know, again, that it wasn't newsworthy because, well, there were no flashy images coming out of there at the time. Now there's video coming out showing what happened in the Solomon Islands, guys. It's just, it was heavy. I mean, the movement was really heavy. And they have urban areas there. They really do. I didn't know they did. I thought it was more, you know, an unpopulated island region, but man, it's actually populated. So they got video of it. Go check it out. Solomon Islands earthquake for just this week, and you'll see it. Shaking buildings, people falling over in the street from the shaking, motorcycle, you have to put it down, can't drive it, that kind of stuff. Traffic intersection stop, people running out in the streets. Yeah. Oh, boy. So there's our update for tonight. Look, hey, guys and gals, girls and boys, whoever you are, bots and whoever, bots and aliens, take a look at the screen. This is the last week's worth of earthquakes. This is a noteworthy increase by any standards. And you can follow the traceable line going from the West Pacific, following our red lines, going all the way over to our termination points at the Mid-Atlantic Ridge. Not just through Europe, but look in the United States. Oh, that's the other thing. The largest earthquake of the year for the U.S. struck. 6.5. Largest one of the year, guys. It's December, or the year's almost over. So, nobody reported on that either. Largest earthquake of the year. I mean, maybe I need to work in the media because, man, they're missing a story. Okay? So, largest earthquake of the year in the West Pacific, largest earthquake of the year for the United States. Both struck in the same day, couple days' time. East Coast moved, new swarm in the Midwest, swarms going down South America, Central America, even following our progression lines right across the Pacific. Again, we put these arrows on the map before these earthquakes hit, guys. And these arrows are going to stay on the map after these earthquakes disappear because there's going to be a new round that follows these roadmaps, this roadmap showing seismic pressure transfer and which way the earthquakes go across the planet. If you see large movement upstream from you or upriver from you, so to speak, you know to watch for large movement downstream. Look, if you see a storm coming and it's dropping, you live on a river, and there's a huge storm upstream that deposits a foot of rain all at once, you know that's going to send a deluge of water down the river and flood you out, right? Well, the same thing applies for seismic pressure traveling down these zones. The larger the movement up the stream, you gotta watch out downstream and be prepared for it like you're preparing for a flood coming. Okay? It's a good analogy. It's one we should use going forward. Like flood preparation, we have to prepare for a deluge of seismic pressure. And it takes about a few days' time for that pressure to transfer across a plate. It's amazing. It really is. I haven't seen it take usually more than a week. It usually takes 5 to 7 days at the most. And our turnaround times are usually less than that. So, you know, 2 to 3 days, but usually at the most 4 to 5. All right, so that's what we've got for you. Please subscribe. If you like my work, if you like what I do, please consider subscribing to my channel. It's how I grow on YouTube. And you know, people pay attention to the numbers and all that stuff. I don't see a difference, really. I'm trying to get the warnings out to the world, and whether we got 100,000 subscribers or 10 million subscribers, I rely on you guys to actually do the sharing and the warning to your friends, family, loved ones, coworkers, professionals, that kind of stuff. And you're welcome to watch. Look, that's what the stream is here for. You can watch and compare to the areas that we name. You can watch the silent zones be hit. You can watch the pressure transfer across the plates following our red lines. The red lines took me 7 years to figure out which way everything goes on the planet, guys. 7 years of observation every day. No weekends off. And that's no exaggeration. You guys have been here to see it. So the process of discovery has been a public one, a long and arduous road, and you can now see it. It's paying off before your eyes. Any professional that was denying progression, notice they got quiet. They can't deny it now. It's on a map. It's on a map they can review and watch progress. So even the biggest skeptic in the world can watch the progression. And it's not like it's just we're getting lucky. It's that that's the way the planet moves, apparently. I don't know how they could have missed it. Really. But they did. So here we are, right? And that's why we're on YouTube, of all the places in the world. Love it, love it, love it. Yeah, so I've got some other stuff to do tonight. First of all, I wrote 30 thank you letters. 30 thank you letters to my viewers who wrote me previously this week. Packages, letters, that kind of stuff. Everything from to Oregon, to Arizona, to Minnesota, to BC, Canada, to California, to Hawaii, back to Oregon, going over to Italy and Switzerland. So got packages or letters going out there. And then I've got to do a massive unboxing. I went to my P.O. box yesterday and we have a stack more of letters, packages, and boxes. And I don't even know where to begin. It's going to take me forever to go through all this stuff. So tonight, I think at midnight, right after midnight, I'll get back on, fired up, and we will go through the boxes and do another unboxing video. I can't let it wait because if it piles up, I get stuck with writing 30 or 40 thank you letters that took me 4 hours because I like to, you know, I like to do it myself. I don't have my wife or anybody else do it for me, so I write them, hand address them, stamp them, and took a long time to do it. So I will be doing this tonight. So tonight at midnight, right after midnight. And the reason I'm going to do it after midnight is so it gets on tomorrow's rotation for YouTube and YouTube videos and all that stuff, for rotation for tomorrow's videos. All right. Yeah, that's all I got for you. Thanks for being part of this. And don't be scared. That's the one thing that is the worst thing about earthquakes is a lot of people get scared. Okay? You don't need to be scared because now you can see which way the pressure transfers. You can see it coming your way. It's like a storm. So you can know where the storm is by looking at the radar, right? Well, you would look at the pressure transferring across the globe in this case. And you'll know it's coming your way. And you know the magnitudes that we're talking about here are in the 5 range right now. Which means that while it's a large earthquake and it has a potential to cause some shaking and some things to fall off the shelves and scare you and scare your pets or your kids, that it's not usually enough to cause serious destruction, knock down buildings, that kind of stuff. We're not looking for that right now. So you can take a deep breath. The populated areas that we are watching, if we see anything larger coming, I will try and jump on and let you know. As it stands right now, you know the deal as best as I can tell you, and you can watch it happen before your eyes to see if anything new develops. If we see any new deep earthquakes, again, if, that could increase things. We could then see sixes instead of fives. So we really need to watch for these new deep earthquakes. And you see the deep earthquakes raised high off the globe. So they're standing very high off the globe. You can see them when they happen. Shouldn't be that big of a deal. And for the areas that we've warned, shouldn't be that big of a deal either, since we're only talking in the 5 range. I don't want you to panic. Don't want you to be scared. Okay? Yeah. So word up. Been fun. I'll be back in a little while, guys, and we'll have some fun opening this stuff up. Maybe I'll even crack a beer. Might even crack a beer. I mean, it would be kind of weird for me to do it. It's middle of the week. It's Tuesday going into Wednesday. Oh, man, that'd be weird. Yeah, I might need to buck the trend and do that while I'm opening these packages. Yeah. All right. We got a plan. Packages and beer. See you guys in an hour and a half.